was great.
Just one surprise up our sleeves.
But at least we have seen once again that in football, 2 and 2 is almost never 4. It's most of the time 3 or 5. Thank you.
Only half came for it, and it's scored! Dennis Lawrence has headed Trinidad and Tobago into the lead. It's the Wrexham defender who's changed the whole emphasis of the tie. Hassan Ali, the Bahrain goalkeeper, hasn't made an error up to now. Yorke's corner, it was tempting for the keeper. He started to come and seemed to stop halfway to the ball. And it's the giant frame, all 6'6" of Dennis Lawrence.
Lawrence and his teammates flew back to Port of Spain, where they received a hero's welcome. So, has their remarkable success sunk in yet?
To be honest, like, if I was in Trinidad, like, it would have been difficult to say that it's actually sunk in, because I probably would have been still partying all now. But, you know, coming back now to my club, you know, my place of duty, it's took a bit of a shine off it, because I've got to get myself back in the frame of mind. I've got a job to do with this club, and that's to achieve, you know, what we want to achieve. And at the moment, like, the way we're trying to, you know, get ourselves promoted into another division. So it's probably sunk in here. Now it's deep at the chill at the moment, like, but it will in due time, it will, I'm sure.
Group B seeds are the three lions of England. They'll be facing World Cup veterans Paraguay, the new boys from the Caribbean, Trinidad and Tobago, and the Scandinavian machine of Sweden. England is the seeded country in Group B, but coming to the World Cup not having won a major football tournament of any kind since 1966. However, with a young team full of international stars, expectations are high, and not just among the fans. Yet another nation playing in the World Cup finals for the first time. Trinidad and Tobago will arrive in Germany after a miraculous and dramatic qualifying campaign. Sharing in the drama was Port Vale midfielder Chris Birchall, born in Stafford, England, but under FIFA rules eligible for Trinidad and Tobago because his mother was born in Port of Spain.
We needed to beat Mexico on the last day, and we just played out of our skin, and it was one of them days that Mexico didn't perform to the best, but we overachieved and we got the result and beat Mexico 2-1.
Mexico took the lead through Yami Lozano, but Trinidad responded through Coventry City striker Stern John, who scored the equaliser just before half-time. And a stunning winner with a half an hour to go. The celebrations were elaborate.
There was more or less pandemonium in the place, you know. Everyone knew that by beating Mexico and getting the playoffs, but we had a real chance of making history and getting into the World Cup. Both playoff games was a bit of caution, and when we played them first at home, we didn't really play to the normal ability that we did, because we were kind of waiting to see what the team had to offer, more or less. And then when we did see what they have, I think we went over there to their country and did what we had to do.
That historic win over Mexico meant a trip to Germany was almost in their grasp, but they had to win a World Cup playoff over two legs to get there. Opponents Bahrain secured a 1-1 draw in Trinidad, and with an away goal in their back pocket, they had the upper hand. But it was the tiny Caribbean football island that prevailed, thanks to giant veteran Wrexham defender Dennis Lawrence. Another historic victory and a true team effort.
I think that's why we've done so well in qualifying, really, because we've got a mixture of youth and the senior players. So, especially for me personally, playing in the middle of with Dwight, the experience he brings and the support he gives you.
Dwight Yorke and others, you know, they bring a sort of calmness or sort of reassurance to the team.
Like, everyone knows Shaka from his days at Newcastle, and now he's at West Ham, and he's a great keeper.
I think they bring that older brother mentality to the team, you know, and it definitely helps us, those with the young players who are not coming up, like myself, Birchall and all of that.
The opposition they're most looking forward to? Of course, it's England.
We were all thinking, yeah, we're going to get in England's group, because most of us are playing out here anyhow, you know. And if we don't get England, we're going to get Brazil. And it so happened that we ended up in England's group, though. You know, it's not just to go there and just show up. We're going there to make it to at least the furthest stage we can.
If we can get off to a good start by either getting a point against Sweden, or if we play out of the skin and get a win, that'd be amazing. But I think everyone in the Trinidad camp is looking forward to the Paraguay game, because that's the last game, and I think we'll be going all out to win. And I think if we do play well, we've got a good chance in that one.
you know, we were following the coach's instructions in terms of preparation, you know, getting our fitness levels up to make a good account of ourselves. We were trying to get the tactical aspect of our game right. We were trying to get our fitness levels up to board of international football at that level. And it was just a fantastic experience, you know, all the preparation games, playing different teams who played different styles of football, working on our particular style of play, our game plan. It was amazing. And then we got to Germany, you know, and the reception from everybody in Germany was great, you know. There was a lot of fans from Trinidad, from all over the world who were there as well. A lot of fans from Scotland as well, you know. So it was an amazing experience.
Well, we had a good preparation. We were 14 days in Austria. It was very tough for the guys. We played some very tough matches, but we think we are ready for it. So, looking forward to the first match.
First for everyone, it's a very historical moment for our people, our team, for our country, and we're here to enjoy every minute of it.
Everybody's full World Cup, so everybody's excited. Yeah.
I expect that we're going to surprise somebody in our group. You know, we've got at least one surprise up our sleeves. You know, but we're realistic at the same time. You know, we're not going to win the tournament. But as I say, we feel that we have enough for us to surprise one or two teams in our group.
Das konnten die Spieler aus der Karibik kaum glauben und hielten jede Minute ihres Empfangs fest. Mehrere hundert Rotenburger standen Spalier, um die Soca Warriors, so nennen sich die Karibik-Kicker, zu empfangen. 500 Meter vom Bus zum Hotel. Die Spieler genossen jeden Zentimeter.
Really, really fantastic. And
einfach
really
fantastisch. Wir fühlen uns wie zu Hause mit diesem tollen Empfang.
Thank you very much.
Have a good time. Und das war ihnen anzusehen. Vor dem Hotel eine kleine Happy Hour. Trainer Leo Behnhacker und seine Mannschaft mittendrin. Und konnte sich über viele neue Unterschriften im goldenen Buch freuen. Um Fußball ging es am Ende des Tages auch noch. Die Trinis traten spontan gegen mittelalterliche Marktbeschicker an und feierten den 1:0-Sieg wie die Weltmeister. Und wenn's im Turnier...
...out for you during this period in terms of team bonding and the players more or less becoming a tighter unit as we headed into this week's game?
Like I said, just a lot of players, you know, who had a vast amount of experience. You know, we had quite a few players into their late 20s, early 30s kind of thing, and you know, this was the opportunity and the stage we all wanted to play on since we started to play football, really. You know, so there was nothing that was going to stand in our way at that time. We knew that in order to do well in this tournament, we had to bond as a team. We know we had to work hard for each other. We know we had to maintain a certain level of discipline and fitness. We know that our nation was dependent on us to instill a certain pride. We know that we wanted to become known as a footballing nation. And I think we achieved all these things in Germany.
They win. I say they win. I love Trinidad and Tobago.
As the countdown continued towards the opening match versus Sweden, the moments varied from being tense at times to one of necessary relax as this country prepared for its first ever match on the world's biggest football stage. Defender Marvin Andrews pulled up injured a couple days before the opener, and in that training session, Ben Hacker switched Kenwyn Jones to a defensive position. We hear more from defender Brent Sancho about what transpired then, and goalkeeper Shaka Hislop relives the historic moment of the 0-0 draw with Sweden for us.
So it was one of those where Marvin went down in the training session before. And looking at the physios on the team, it looked like they gave Leo the signal that he might not be okay for the game against Sweden. Immediately, Leo put Kenwyn Jones at the back during our scrimmage session. I was extremely disappointed. I remember when we broke for water break, saying to Atiba Charles that I can't believe I still gave him a chance to play. I was so disappointed. We went back to the hotel, obviously had dinner. Shaka and I always had power hours before every game at night at the hotel. And I was saying to him, almost we were both like two females crying to each other, basically saying that, you know, we really want our opportunity to play. That being said, the next day in training, the day when we flew down to Dortmund, we had a session before, and Leo saw me, was a bit, I wouldn't say angry, but obviously I had a lot of tension within me because obviously I was disappointed that I didn't play or wasn't selected to play or believe I wasn't going to be selected to play. And he pulled me aside and he said to me, you seem a bit disappointed. And I said, yeah, I'm very disappointed because I was hoping to get an opportunity to play. And he said to me, your feeder should be playing. And I was like, yeah, I think so. He's like, okay, well, you're playing tomorrow. And I think when he said those words, I think it was a combination of unbelief. I couldn't believe what was happening. And at the same point in time, it was a euphoric joy. I was going through work. I was like an emotional roller coaster. I remember I was zipping around the training ground afterwards. And I think, you know, the day after, I mean, I told Shaka about it. He was really happy for me. Obviously, I was a little bit disappointed he wasn't playing. And then, lo and behold, the day of the game, Kelvin Jack pulled up as well, and then Shaka was given his chance. So, I mean, it happened. I mean, it's like almost like a storybook ending because we spoke about it all through, and then we got our opportunities. But of course, the game itself is just something that will always live on in my memory.
Well, probably about 3 or 4 days before the game, I started to realize that, I wasn't starting. I knew I wouldn't be starting with Kelvin Jack, who was to be playing number one. But I started to get the impression that I wasn't even going to be on the bench. And at the time, we thought there'd be 18 on the bench, which means, you know, only two goalkeepers would be named. And I started to believe that it would be Clayton Ince. And that kind of, that certainly upset me. And then, got me thinking. And it wasn't until the day before the game, the Friday, we were training in Dortmund, and Leo Benaka called me to the middle of the pitch to tell me that I was going to be his third choice goalkeeper for the Sweden game. And though Kelvin had been nursing an injury, it was expected that he'd be fit. But if he wasn't, he was going to go with Clayton Ince. And that upset me for a number of reasons, because I felt that I'd done enough to be number two. And the reasons he gave me were that he felt I'd been too relaxed in the build-up, which, you know, I took exception to. I felt somebody needed to be relaxed. That a lot of things that were happening in the camp, obviously everybody was kind of nervous about our first World Cup appearance, and it had got, things were tense, and I felt that we needed to have some kind of a release. We needed to have we needed to be able to let our hair down and laugh a little bit. So I felt he was being unfair in his judgment of me in that regard, and it really upset me. I spoke to my wife that night and told her the news, and just overnight I kind of decided, listen, you know, I'm a fan. I was a fan a long time before I was a player, and I'll be a fan of Trinidad and Tobago football a long time after I finished retiring. So I was going to go there. I was going to enjoy the game as a fan in a very good seat. I'd become, I'm going to say, comfortable with the decision, but I'd accepted my role for that day.
Qualified for World Cup 10 years ago, and what goes through your mind when you think of things like this?
Oh well, obviously, you know, it's one of the greatest, you know, feelings of, you know, Trinidad and Tobago history. Obviously, you know, to qualify for the first ever World Cup, obviously it's 10 years, it shows you that time is not waiting for anyone, and you know, I would really love to see that, you know, the team continue to grow and continue to increase, and you know, for make a history as well again, you know, by making the smallest country to qualify for the second World Cup, you know. It's not impossible. So just, you know, loads of work need to be done, you know, they just need to keep coming together, because I believe that when we showed in 2006, when we come together as a nation, we're unstoppable.
You know, had a very good night's sleep, no nerves at all, no butterflies at all. Woke up next morning, had far too big a breakfast because I wasn't expecting to be playing, so I was just eating as much as I, eating whatever I felt like eating. And we got to, and the day kind of progressed as such, you know. I saw a lot of Trinidad fans came to the team hotel, including my wife, my mom, both my brothers, my kids were there. So I got to see them before we boarded the team bus to head to the stadium. And then we got there, and again, it was the same kind of easy approach from me. At one point, I was actually kicking shots at Clayton Innes and not too fussed about what was to come. And then I just remember I was behind the goal, and Kelvin turned to me and said, you know, I'm not going to be fit, I can't make it. And that was it. And he turned, we didn't have an exchange about it. He just said it and walked towards Leo Benaka. And I stood there just kind of looking at him, you know, walk over to Leo. And I see two of them, their eyes meet, and then they speak. And all the while, I'm just kind of glaring at Benaka, almost in defiance of him not to give me the nod to play against, to play if Kelvin wasn't fit. And our eyes met, and he called me over. It was probably 10 minutes before kickoff, and he said, "You're ready for this?" And I said, "Absolutely." Went to Mike and Maurice came over to do a warm up, and whenever I warmed up, I would always like to go out before everybody else, because and then go back in before everybody else. Because I like to have that time, I like to be first on the pitch. A kind of ownership thing, an ownership mentality. Like, I'm here first, and this is my pitch. And I like to go back in before everybody else, because I like just that little moment of quiet before the storm of a match situation. So, all right, I wasn't out early, but I still said to Michael Maurice, race through a quick warm-up, just get through the basics, and then head in just to be alone with my thoughts before the game, as I always had done. He hit a few at me just to catch, kind of straightforwardly. My handling was clean, I was quite happy with that. I felt good. I didn't get to do any crosses, which I knew I was taking a risk with, because they had introduced this new ball that was flying differently. And they introduced this new ball for the World Cup that was flying differently, and every stadium, every atmosphere, you know, the ball just travels differently. You like to take a few crosses just to see how the ball flight is. But I knew I was going back in and didn't take any crosses, and I made my mind up that whenever Sweden, you know, whenever they got a corner, their first corner or first cross, I was going to come for it regardless. And hope that I didn't pay a heavy price for it, but I just made my mind up that I was going to come for it no matter what, and just pick up the flight of the ball from that cross. And that's exactly what happened. Sweden got a corner early on in the game. I can't remember exactly what minute, but it was very early on in the game. And I made my mind up, no matter where that cross was going, if it was at the edge of the box, I was going for it. As it happens, it was deep. It was probably about 10 or 12 yards out. I came a long way for it, and as I expected, it kind of sailed over my head. I was just able to get a fingertip to it. And it felt kind of harmlessly, you know, we went past all these Swedish attackers or something of the sort. But then I realized, okay, the ball is flying just marginally more than you expected, than I expected it to. So therefore, I just kind of adjusted my approach to suit. And that was it. The rest of the game kind of spoke for itself. And it was, like I said before, I was feeling good. I was focused and things just fell into place from there.
Starting to drift now more and more in search of the ball. It's a good clip cross towards Larsen. Electric football. Freddie Ljungberg's cross beautifully floated. And a dramatic header from Henrik Larsen.
Fabulous play. Terrific ball by Ljungberg. And Larsen's run across the defender was brilliant there.
Trying to be patient. Ibrahimovic on by Larsen. It'll come for Wilhelmsen. It's a really good save by Shaka Hislop. Wilhelmsen heading back into the danger area by Lindroth, headed away by Gray. Seems to pop up Ibrahimovic. Another good reaction stop from Hislop. Gray panicked into a clearance by Ljungberg.
Okay, Sam, let's get back to the action.
Start of the first half by speculating that the group could be how many everybody else scores against Trinidad and Tobago. Well, the sum total so far is none. They have acquitted themselves superbly. Here's Zlatan Ibrahimovic with Ljungberg for company. Ibrahimovic goes tumbling and looking for a free kick. And a problem here for Avery John. I think it could be his second yellow card. Slid in, got the ball, but he's off. Well, that changes everything. The referee from Singapore, Shamsui Maidin, has shown a red card within 30 seconds of the restart to Avery John, who has been rather rash with his tackles. I think he got the ball, but I think it was a dangerous tackle.
It's not about me too much in the sense that, listen, we went out as a team. We did what we had to do. We didn't concede any goal. I think we came under heavy criticism. Most of the time, you know, the defense had letting up a lot of goal. But we did our job. When you look at the game, everybody, you know, each and every player, the guys coming in, from the goalkeeper straight front, everybody putting their really 100% effort. And I guess that has a lot to do with preparation from, you know, from the staff, and then also, you know, the great support from the fans. On me, I mean, getting sent off, I want to apologize to the guys in there. It sense that, you know, they play with 10 men instead of 11. But once again, I mean, it's in the game. I mean, I'm that kind of person. I'm a passionate person. If I see the ball, I go for it. And I didn't think it was caused for a red card. I mean, if you look wide, the tackles and everything going in, I got the ball first, and you know, I could have just gotten over the warning. But as I say, it happened. I can't do anything about it. The most I can do is be a good team player and just have the team prepare for the next game against England.
Now a little bit of space here for Freddie Ljungberg. Carlos Edwards again, outstanding.
Defended really well, hasn't he, there? Two or three times in the last 10 minutes.
Eric Edmund with a cross throw. Ibrahimovic! Is it far away? Now, here's an opportunity for Cornell Glenn. Oh, it's a great effort, and he twanged the crossbar. From an impossible angle, facing impossible odds. Trinidad and Tobago almost took the lead.
Incredible strike. We're sitting right behind that, and you're thinking, well, oh, he's not going to shoot from there, is he? Oh, he has. Goodness me. Fantastic shot.
It's one of those where the goalkeeper says, go on then, shoot. I'm all right. Cornell Glenn. And he's gone away from Gray, and he's turned it across the face of goal, and Holbeck couldn't reach it.
Maybe Youngberg can still set something up, though. Mistake by Carlos Evans. He got back and got the ball.
Great tackle. What a recovery tackle that was.
Well, at first I was a bit nervous because, you know, it's a big stage, the biggest stage in world football. But at the same time, you know, it's a beautiful game of football, and you want to go there and do your best and enjoy the game. And the experience says it all. I mean, it was a bit despondent after a while when we did went out to 10 men, but the guys knew what they were capable of. We knew what we were able to do, and we went out there with all heads high. I mean, we were the underdogs from even before we actually qualified for the World Cup, but we showed the world that, you know, we're just not Trinidad and Tobago with 1.3 million people, but we are a nation that is a small nation with a big heart and big expectations and things that we hope to achieve more. It is good in the aspect that he's one of the most experienced players in the team. He is the captain, and everyone look up to him as a role model and as the leader, not just because he's a captain, but because he has achieved a lot of things, and people expect him to go out there and try to lead us in the right way. And I think all the guys took to him, and we know that, you know, he's not going to lead us astray. And in return, we as the players have to give him that support also, because he can't do it on his own. He can only, you know, give us that encouragement to go out there and try to do things better. But in return, we have to show that, you know, we are capable of competing against the best.
Larsen, Kjellstrom, a lot of space here. Rolled into Ibrahimovic, allowed to turn. Caught it well. And it flew over the crossbar into those supporters. They've done it! Trinidad and Tobago have held Sweden. A match to remember these opening stages by, an unlikely encounter between two teams from contrasting cultures, with a hot favourite and a wild outsider, and nothing to separate them. Thanks to the brilliance of Shaka Hislop and the sheer pride of the men in red. And England will have to play some to beat them on Thursday. 0-0 here in Dortmund.
Difficult. They were a little bit impressed about the whole atmosphere. At the moment, I was sure that the second half we could do much better and even go for the win. However, you never know. But when you have to play at the end about 44 minutes with 10 guys to 11, when you see the difference, they bring a front line with guys from Anderlecht, from Juventus, from Barcelona, from Arsenal. We bring a big guy from Jablote, I'm sure you never heard of it, from Gillingham, I'm sure you have to see your papers where it is, from Wrexham, and from New England Revolution from the United States. So in that way, of course, with all my respect for the opponent and all opponents we will meet, and it's not any guarantee for the next match versus England, I know that, but at least we have seen once again that in football, 2-2 is almost never 4, it's most of the time 3 or 5. Thank you.
Binhaka's men returned to Rottenburg the night of the match, and next day at training, there were a couple hundred TNT fans waiting for the players as they arrived for training on their bicycles. We hear from Dwight Yorke on his reactions to the historic draw.
It's without a doubt, it's a massive achievement for our country, for the people. It's a very historical moment for our country, and obviously credit to the players on the day, because, you know, a lot of people don't expect us to do extremely well in this tournament or this competition, and we come here with a determination to prove a lot of people wrong. And even though we had went down with one man less, we've shown a lot of character, a lot of determination through the players, and obviously I'm delighted about the outcome of the result.
How much did you have to change your plan on the field as captain when we went down to 10 men?
Not a lot. You just have to keep your composure and keep believing in what we were doing. As I said, it was always going to be difficult with 11 men, let alone 10 men on the football pitch. But what I've seen in the players this time round is that I've seen the maturity in the team. A team that I probably would have thought maybe 5 years ago would have folded and been beaten 3-4, 5-0 possible. But you know, it goes to show that this team has come a long way in a year's time that I've been with the team. And as I said, all credit to the players.
In the context of your own career, how important is yesterday? Where does it figure?
It's magnificent. I mean, obviously, without the doubt, you know, the treble winning year at Manchester United and winning all those trophies was absolutely phenomenal. But, you know, when you're talking about your country, representing your country, being the captain of your country in a world stage, in a world tournament, there's not a bigger honour than that. And as much as I'm happy to be associated with Manchester United and the treble winning year, this has got to be the top of the tree.
One final question, the coach Bean Hacker and Trinidad and Tobago, rate him in the context of Trinidad and Tobago's football. How much of a difference has he made to the psyche of the people and to the team?
He's a massive influence, you know. He's a very whole, what you said, a whole campaigner, who's been around the block, so to speak. And he's brought in a sense of belief in the team, and the players have responded to that. And it can only be credit to Benaka and his staff. I must say, the people behind the scene doesn't get a lot of credit for what they have done, but there's a lot of hard work been put in there. And as I said, there's a lot of belief that is installed into the players through the management staff. And as I said, the players have responded to that in a positive way. And we're all excited and delighted that we had such a great manager on our side.
Chris, goalkeeper.
Amici di Sky, appassionati di calcio, benvenuti a Norimberga, Frankenstadion da Piero Gibardo
e Antonio Di Gennaro.
Questa è Inghilterra, Trinidad.
definitely I wanted to be there. You know, I remember before we went to the World Cup, I came back and I was quite happy in helping the team and the nation to achieve our goals, which was getting to the World Cup. And I had a conversation with the coach, Mr. Ben Hacker, and I kind of said to him at the time that, not kind of, I did say to him at the time that, listen, I understand at my age, you know, you probably wanted to take younger players on younger legs to the World Cup, and that would be all right with me. And he was adamant that no, he wanted me to go. So yeah, so I did my best to get myself as fit as possible and to prepare as best as I can. And yeah, I wanted to play. But again, you know, I'm into coaching now, and I understand things a lot more. You know, to play against England, I wanted to play against Sweden, I wanted to play against Paraguay. I want to play all the time that I'm involved in the team, but it's a coach's decision, and you have to trust it. And the team did really well, you know, even against England. We were holding on, we were giving as good as we got. They had to make a lot of changes in order, because as far as the world media is concerned and world football is concerned, if England had drawn with Trinidad, that's, you know, that's devastating to their reputation in football. And again, Shaka had a fantastic game, but it was a marvelous strike from Steven Gerrard, Peter Crouch goal, which is always debatable with the foul on Brent and that sort of stuff. But I suppose we always see it in football sometimes when you're a bigger nation. You get the benefit of the doubt in terms of decisions that is made by the officials.
I think when they set up to take, when the cross was coming in, I remember looking for my mark, because the Paraguayans, in terms of their dead balls coming in the box, I mean, they were playing in the balls with a lot of pace. So we were worried that although we may have been physically bigger than them, the pace of the and the trajectory of the free kicks, etc., that's coming in the box, combined with their movement, was giving us some problems. So I remember looking around for my mark, and by the time I looked back around, the ball was already on its way, coming towards me. And it was a split second decision. I wasn't sure if to move, to duck out the way, because I was concerned, obviously, if I left it behind me, the marker would score. And by the time it came off my head, I knew it was going into the back of the net. It was one of those gut-wrenching experiences. I felt like a knife went through my heart, because I let my teammates down. But I think the reaction of the guys after it happened was one that will always live on with me, is that everybody looked around and said, listen, we'll go and get it back. You know what, we'll go and get this goal back.
Nothing to prove, you know. I was part of a team that went there to do our best, and we all had our parts to play. It was a game, if we wanted to get to the latter stages of the competition, we had to win to be in with a chance. So I knew the opportunity to get on the field to create something offensively, create goals or score goals would come, depending on how the game was going. So I was ready, and I just wanted to enjoy the whole experience of in my latter years, realizing my dream of finally playing on the biggest world stage. So. I think I went on with about 25 minutes or something like that, and you know, I just thoroughly enjoyed that 25 minutes, you know. I can remember that Dwight was firing some into me in really difficult positions, and I was taking it and trying to create. And I know I had a great chance in the game, a difficult chance, but a good chance for me. You know, there was a ball that Carlos played on to Kenwin, who headed it down, and I think I just kind of misjudged the flight of the ball a bit and just got onto it. Just a bit too late, and it was a good half volley on my left foot, but I just couldn't keep it down with the timing of not getting to the ball quick enough, you know. But again, it was a wonderful experience for me, and it is my belief that as a staff and a team, I think we did the nation really proud. I think one of the most important things about that whole experience for me was that the idea of being able to dream as big as you can and realizing your dreams. You know, if you speak to my mom, my family, that kind of thing, they would always say to you, as a kid, you know, I mean, maybe less than 10 years old, I would say, yeah, I'll go to the World Cup. I'm going to take Trinidad to the World Cup. You know, and I was able to achieve that at 37 years old, you know. And like I said, when I was going to Tranquility, and I said to my teacher, you know, the teachers would go around and they would say, well, what do you want to be when you get older? And I said, well, I want to be a footballer, you know. And she was going, don't be crazy, boy, you know. There isn't any football here, professional football in Trinidad and that sort of stuff, you know. But I believe that I wanted to be it, and I believe also that I was given a gift of playing football, and I was able to achieve that. So that was important to me, you know. And one of the major things that I say to a lot of the young players that I coach now is that don't be afraid to dream, and dream as big as you can. And if you work as hard as you can, then these dreams can become a reality. And in response to the question about Coach Ben Hacker, a fantastic coach, and he did an amazing job with us in a short time. In saying that, though, I think in order to achieve things, a lot of things have to align at the same time. And I think as a nation, we were lucky to have the right coach at the right time. But I think he was also lucky to have the right bunch of players at the same time, you know. He had a blend of experience, of youth, of talent, of creativity, and all this came together at the same time. But the most important lesson that I learned from him that I pass on to my young players now, and it's something that I believe in, and he always said to us, is that whatever we do as a team, as long as we do it as a team, we stand a chance. And if I can explain that a bit further, you know, there are games that you play, and sometimes you're on the back foot and you need to defend, but players, instead of holding their formation and defending, holding their shape and defending, some players attack, you know. And his idea behind this whole scenario was that, okay, we cannot attack for five players and defend five players, then we disjointed as a team, right? And but if we all attack as 11 players, all defend as 11 players, then it doesn't matter who we play against, then we stand a chance. And that is what a team sport is about. And this is one of the things that I sincerely believe in, and this is one of the things that I always pass on to all the teams and young players that I'm involved with coaching. We'll be right back.
So the treasury broke and they say that recession jamming. So no foreign countries really start migrating. They lose faith in the country, they say we gone down the drain. They say no more could we see happy times again. But the will to recover in my people, like have confidence. Although many may seem to feel that I talking nonsense, but the majority of we decide we're not going to run. Because now is the time to show we patriotism. For we country facing its darkest hour. So our people need us today more than ever. But in our fight to recover, if ever you feel to surrender, it have one little thing that I want you always remember. We could make it if we try. Positive move to solve.